Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to part 2 from this talk about the end of hadith era in Saudi Arabia and subsequently in the rest of the world. And we are going to speak about a king which changed the face of Islam from the 5th or end of the 4th century all the way to our times. That is 1400, meaning this king has changed the face of Islam for the last 950 years. What people today believe in, how they act, what they preach, what everything that you know about Islam that you know today was decided by that king. And this is scary, because oftentimes when I get into discussion or debates or arguments, whatever, I avoid arguments the moment things start getting argumenty. I just leave. But what I noticed is every time I speak to people, every time I debate an issue, every time I challenge a belief, I realize that these people have actually no idea about the history. And this creates a big problem, because when you speak to them, you have knowledge to back you up. They have emotions only. And this makes a big problem. It's like someone, you're trying to talk to somebody about the Second World War, but they have no idea. They have no information. They don't know the history. They just have a general broad idea. So when you get into the nitty gritty, into small details of the war, they will argue, they will reject, they will call you a liar, they will do everything. Why? It's because they lack the informations which you have, which led you to whatever belief you've got. So when we speak to people about the Quran being the sole authority, and they're opposing us and they call us names and all that kind of stuff, it's because these people actually possess no real knowledge. They have a general broad idea, but when it comes to knowledge, hey, guess what? They don't have it. But as I said, back in time, in the year, at the end of the 4th century, beginning of the 5th century, there was a man, a king from the Abbasi dynasty. He was known by Al-Qadir Billah. That's how he was known. And Al-Qadir Billah is really a description, not his name. And it means the one who is able by the grace of Allah, or he is capable of being great with the help of Allah. These kind of titles were used by the Abbasi kings in the second dynasty of the Abbasis to make their status tied to Allah and Islam. Because you see, if someone's name is Ali or Omar or Hussein, whatever name they got, it's a name. But once you link their name to Allah, then people, especially when they are a king, then people will not go against them, they will not uprise, they will do nothing. And that was the concept, that was the idea before that. Just to give you an idea, the Abbasi dynasty, the whole of the dynasty, has been ruled by 37 kings. And it went for 500 years. Out of these 37 kings, 24 of these 37 used titles where Allah's name was linked to the name. Al-Muqtadir Billah, Al-Mu'tasim Billah, Al-Kafi Billah, Al-Qa'im Billah, Al-Nasr Billah. Everything ends with by Allah, by Allah. So what interests us here is this king, Al-Qadir Billah, the one who is able and capable by the grace of Allah. But his true name, his real name, is Ahmed ibn Ishaq. He was the 25th king in the Abbasi dynasty. He ascended the throne in year 381 Hijri, that is towards the end of the 4th century, which to us in the Gregorian calendar, or as the religiously called the Christian calendar, but it's a Gregorian calendar, it was around the 9th and 10th, towards the end of the 9th century and beginning of the 10th. Today we are 21st century, we're speaking 11th century. Centuries ago. So in year 420, and this is the date I want you to remember, please, as you listen to these talks, take notes, really do. Because when you take notes, they empower you in your conversation. When you talk to people, you become powerful, because you know Al-Qadir Billah did this in year that, and this is what affected my Islam. So you become empowered. empowered, really. But anyhow, in year 420, that is the beginning, the first part of the 5th century, which is equivalent to 1029 Gregorian or Christian calendar, something big happened. And that thing would change the face of Al-Islam for whatever seems like an eternity. Of course, until now, that is, because now that Muhammad bin Salman of Saudi Arabia has said no, things are going to change. It was a Friday, and the people of Baghdad, the capital of the Abbasid dynasty, and what also meant the capital of the entire Muslim world. And when I say the entire Muslim world, I'm talking from the Arabian Peninsula, from Yemen, all the way to northern parts of Iraq, where the capital was. And then you go from the east, beyond what's Iran today, all the way to the western part, which is Morocco, and then you have North Africa, southern parts of Africa. So the spread of the Abbasi Empire was actually big, even going to Spain, to the, until the southern parts of Paris. So that's, we're talking about a huge empire. So, but in Baghdad, and because it happened in Baghdad, it's just a matter of time where it spreads. But the reason why, because from the time they decided on what I'm gonna tell you, until they implemented it, they took some time, because what the king wanted, Qadir Billah, what he wanted was that every part in the empire, they would do the same things, so that the entire empire follows the same thing at the beginning of the same date and everything. So on that fateful Friday, people in Baghdad or any other part of the Muslim world were getting ready. It was Friday and people got ready to go to Jummah. And when they got to the Jummah, they were expecting the Imam to go on top of the minbar. Fear Allah, don't love the dunya, think about the hereafter. You know, the usual talk. But people were surprised. They saw the sheikhs mounting the minbar or the pulpit. And instead of delivering the khutbah, they pulled a piece of paper and they started reading whatever was in that paper. And what was in that paper is what became the blueprint of Al-Islam until our times. You, me, everybody else that says La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, and is doing the salat and following things like that, is more than 100% following what was decided on that paper. That paper was the official government release, so to speak. Later on, the historians called that, whatever the imams read on that Jummah, the Qadiriyya decree, al-wathiqa al-Qadiriyya. Or they refer to it in the Muslim world as the Qadiri creed, al-i'tiqad al-Qadiri. What was in that piece of paper is whatever you know about Al-Islam, from the history of the Messenger of Allah, what happened to him in Mecca, the migration, everything that was there. Then later on, any books that were written, and they, those books, followed what was mentioned in that decree, got approved and they were printed and promoted, but any other books that did not submit to what the king had said, they were not printed. And guess what? The punishment was really intense, and I will speak about it in a little bit. So that is what happened. So the people were surprised there. To make this extremely top official, what Al-Qadir Billah, the king, he did something extremely malicious. He invited in Baghdad, in his castle, all the rich people, the dignitaries, the businessmen, all types of sheikhs and scholars, either be them a big scholar, a medium-sized sheikh, or even a preacher, someone who he invited everyone that could influence the general public. They were hadith scholars, historians, people who dealt with the Quran, people who dealt all kinds of knowledges in Islam and else, math, physics. He invited them all in the main city hall. Back in time, it used to be called Dar al-Khilafa. Like today is the government building or the Big Ben or the House of Parliament or whatever it is. But back in time, they used to call it Dar al-Khilafa, the House of the Khilafa. And the reason why he did this is because the king wanted the support of everyone that had a say, and no matter how little it was, he wanted their allegiance. He wanted people to accept the list of beliefs that he approved. And when people in the Dar al-Khilafah, in that House of Parliament, met and they saw what the king had written, then once they know the content of that decree and agree to it, then from that day on, they will only preach what was in that decree. So he gathered them all and he wanted their signatures, and they read what was in that, and they liked what was in there. Reason being, they liked it is simple, really. Because the king, when he invited the different people, he invited the Salafi sheikhs. He invited the business people that had no idea about what's going on in the religious world, right? But mostly what he wanted to do is to push for the Salafi, or what we call today the Sunni world. He didn't call the Shia, he didn't call the Mu'tazila, he didn't call the Ibadiyya, he didn't call the Sufiya, he didn't call the other denomination. He just called a group of people. These people are what today is known as the Sunni, or the Ahl Sunnah. They called them. They came and they liked what he wrote, because what he wrote was exactly what they were pushing for. And because in his time, since the death of Rasulullah, it was civil war after civil war after civil war, and all these disagreements, the fighting, the battles, the lies, the inventions of the hadith, the torturing and manipulation of the Quran and everything. So when the king came, he excluded all the troublemakers and he brought only in those people whom he deemed would help in promoting what he wanted them to promote. Al-Qadir Billah, this man, is a grandson of another king who had, not far off from there, and I don't want to bore you with history, but this is important. You all heard the troubles that Ahmed ibn Hanbal had gone through with the Mu'tazila about the creation of the Qur'an. What actually they mean by the creation of the Qur'an is not that Allah created the Qur'an or not. This is not the point. The appellation of this is wrong. It's a very deceitful way that the sheikhs of the Sunnah, our sheikhs, put the title, because when you hear it, you go, oh, creation of the Quran. And how can Allah create his own voice? That's not true. But it's not what they mean by it is simple, really, but dangerously simple. The Sunni, our sheikh Ahmed ibn Hanbal and all these people, what they said is this. Allah first had decided on the Quran, what is going to go in the Quran, then later on created the entire world based on what Allah had decided first. And this is why the predestination of each and every single human being is decided by Allah first, and then the people will only do. So you, when you fornicate it because predominantly it is Allah who has written this on you. And you will say, then why is he punishing me? They will tell you, oh, what you don't know is this. Because Allah knew you would fornicate in this day. That's why he wrote it. So actually what Allah did is just he manifested what he knew, and you can't challenge Allah. Allah knows everything. So who are you to say that? Of course, this is absolutely rubbish. But in that part of the world, it's Ahmed ibn Hanbal who upheld this belief. This is why today they tell you, oh, this is Qadarullah, this is what Allah has written, patience, this is what Allah wanted. No, this is not what Allah wanted. On the other hand, the Mu'tazila, what they say, absolutely not. Allah has written nothing, and humans are free to do as they please. This is why there is judgment today. And actually, this is the right, correct argument. Because the Quran speaks about this, and as I said in one of my talks before, judgment day is based on 100% freedom. If you have 100% freedom on earth to do as you please, you'll be held accountable 100% of your actions on judgment day. If this freedom is taken away from you and you have no choice, you are forced to do something, then on judgment day, all also Allah will not hold you responsible, because when that act was committed by you in this life, you didn't do, you were forced to doing it. And on Judgment Day, Allah will not force it on you. So the idea of the creation of the Quran is really should be like this. Allah created, decided what's gonna happen first, and then he created the entire world based on his knowledge. This is what they say, the Quran is not created, meaning it's decided and everything. The Mu'tazila, they say, oh, he is created, they mean that events took place, then Allah revealed the Quran. So the Quran has been created, has been produced based on what was going on. I'll give you a small example. When someone dies and people come to you, what do they say? They say it is for Allah what he has created, and it goes back to Allah, and everything is decreed with Allah. وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ عِنْدَهُ بِقَدْرٍ. Everything with Allah is according to the qadr. All these are influences from this king. When people, when something doesn't happen, they say, oh, it was not meant to happen. This is a diabolical. This is untrue. There is no such thing as meant to happen. We make things happen. Allah wants them to happen, or he doesn't want them to happen. That's another issue. But nothing was meant to happen that you didn't want to happen. All happens for a reason. And that reason is our direct input. But anyway, so as he did, he gathered all these people, as I said, in the Dar al-Khilaf, and he wanted them to sign, approve, and so the sheikhs went through, and that decree was read to them, and the Salafi sheikh were absolutely over the moon. Finally, they're going to have everything that they so fought for against all other groups, it's going to prevail. And not only that, in the paper that they read it, they also took the allegiance to the king personally, that these sheikhs are going to not only approve the decree, but they are going to adhere to it and are going to push for it, preach it, teach it, write about it, and everything else that follows. Then once the king got all their allegiance and they agreed and approved, and everybody got a copy of that, and guess what? That decree, the belief, the Qadiri decree or the Qadiri creed, was sent to all corners of his kingdom with specific and special instructions for the sheikhs and the general publics. At that moment there, the sheikhs were getting their money from the government, from the central government, and because of that, they were under the mercy of the king. So either you agree or you disagree, that's what you're going to do. Otherwise, you'll be sacked and fired from your job. But anyway, so the paper went throughout to the whole kingdom, and they say this decree must be read to people, and none is allowed anything else but what is inside this decree. Meaning, no other things can be taught except what's written in this decree. Guess what? History repeats itself. Because what I'm telling you happened in the year 420 Hijri, at the beginning of the 5th century, 1029 years ago in the Christian calendar. Fast forward another 1,000 years and one, and guess what? We are living the same story. Muhammad ibn Salman and Al-Qadir Billah, both of them share the same thing. They're doing exactly the same thing. Muhammad ibn Salman, who is a crown prince, is, guess what? Is deciding on the fate of Saudi Arabia right now. And with that, is deciding on the fate of the entire Islam. Because Saudi Arabia, just like it used money to promote Wahhabism, will use money to promote the Salmanism, the Islam based on Muhammad ibn Salman. That's why I'm telling you, the history repeats itself. You may be now, you are living the times and you see things change, but look at the generations that are going to come later on, 3, 4, 5 generations later on, where they will be preached the version of Al-Islam approved by the Crown Prince Muhammad ibn Salman. The people then, 4, 5, 6, 7 generations from now, they will have an Islam which they think is the true Islam, and they will look at whatever Islam was done before as the wrong. History repeats itself. The problem is, all historians agree that the true author of the Qadiri decree, Al-Wathiqa Al-Qadiriya, or the Qadiri document or policy and everything that the king had other people agree to it, is none other but one single sheikh. His name is Muhammad ibn Ali Al-Karaji. Muhammad ibn Ali Al-Karaji. I know you've never heard of this name. I know of that, that's a fact. And that guy, Muhammad ibn Ali Al-Karaji, is the one behind everything Muslims do, say, believe in, the way they pray, the way they eat, the way they fast, everything. And guess what? He wrote it away from the Quran, because at that moment, in that part of the world, in the 3rd, 4th, 5th century, the Quran was considered a book of troubles. That's why they kept miles away from it. You see, we don't know much about this scholar. We really don't know much about how his life and things. All we know about him, I'm talking about the guy who wrote the decree, Muhammad ibn Ali al-Karaji, is that he is from Persia, from Iran today. That's it. That's all we know. He was well known for his excessive, at that moment there, his love of war. He used to love going to fight, because he used to believe if you die in the path of Allah, for Allah's sake, while killing the kuffar, you will go to Jannah. And of course, it is wrong, the Quran. Allah never said that. But anyhow, that's another story for another day. But that's the mentality. Always remember the love. Ask any Muslim today, what is your highest wish? They will tell you, oh, I want to die martyr. Why? Because all the hadiths about the martyr, and that all the sins of the martyr will be forgiven at the first drop of blood that touches the earth, and that he will be smell like musk. He will take 70 people of his family to paradise. He will have tons of women in there. He will straight to, of course, all these are lies, but those lies were approved. Guess what? You guessed it, in 420 by this king, and then subsequently all the sheikhs that came after that. So this man was a bloodthirsty person, so much so that they called him the throat cutter. The throats, you know, the human throat cutter, because of his sword and killing the people. It's what you call today, he's a hardcore Salafi militant. That's what it is. This scholar, my dear sisters and my brothers, who is behind the Qadiri decree, supported many issues which were a matter of disagreement between the different scholars. But because he followed them, he wrote them, he wrote what he believed in, and then he used the king whom he was close to pass it on people and make it a law in the country. And the king, guess what? He saw in it something that's going to serve him. People are not going to go against him. And guess what? He approved it. And it was in this decree. I'm just going to tell you a couple of things that you see until today. You. Yes, I emphasize with the you, because it's still eating at us today. In this decree, for example, it was decided that all Muslims must come and stand behind their king, no matter what the king did. He must always be obeyed. And then they stipulated that the messenger of Allah said about these kings, أَدُّ لَهُمْ حُقُوقَهُمْ, give them their rights, وَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّكُمْ, and ask of Allah your rights, i.e. obey the king in whatever he decides. And when it comes to your right, ask Allah of them. And this gave an open white check, green card, for the kings to do as they please without ever being questioned about anything that they did. That's why today you hear all sheikhs of Salafism, everybody that is a Sunni, they keep quiet about the kings. No matter what the king does, or the president, or the minister, or anyone who is an authority does, they never ever speak. Why? Because of this Qadiri decree. Another thing that was made law and everybody must follow, and you will see the consequences of it in our days, is that the king, of course the king and behind him that sheikh, made it a law. And that law said, every single Muslim out there that didn't love all the companions, all companions, no exception, is not a Muslim, is not a Muslim. And that's why, and they added all companions, we should say, Allah be pleased with them. Every time you say, Allah be pleased, when you mention the name of a companion, it shows that you love that companion and you respect them. Even though the Quran says the great number of the companions have reverted back to hypocrisy, to disbelief, and Allah in the Quran spoke a lot negatively about what we call companions, but this decree itself and everything else says, no, all the companions are reliable, good, loving, trustworthy people, and we should not accuse them. And on this assumption, they built the hadith strategy, the hadith world, and they just focused it on 5, 6, no more than 10 people who mentioned the hadith. And these 10 people, you cannot even touch them from far. Anyhow, in this decree, they decided that Abu Bakr is the first man who must always be mentioned. After him must Umar, and then Uthman, and then Ali. In this sequence, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. This is why today in your mind, if I say who are the president of the Muslims, you're going to say Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. Even the hadiths, in different hadiths where these personalities are mentioned, it always say Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman. One day they tell you the Messenger of Allah was on Uhud, this mount of Uhud in Al-Madinah. With him was Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman. The hadith, for example, of course this is a hoax hadith, untrue hadith, but they say, but anyhow, it's in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, every books of hadith, about the 10 people that were given the good news that they're going to enter Jannah. The hadith states Abu Bakr in paradise, Umar in paradise, Uthman in paradise, Ali in paradise. It's in this sequence is always mentioned. And he also stated, this king, the Qadiri decree, and this was to show how much they hated the Shia, that no one can speak ill of Aisha. No one can speak bad people things about Aisha, even though the evil she did is incredibly high. Her hate for Fatima. You see, Rasul, they say the Messenger of Allah's house was the wall of his house was close to that of Ali, meaning Fatima lived 2-3 steps away from the Messenger of Allah. You never ever go ahead, scoop the internet, go everywhere, try to find me a hadith where Aisha interacts with Fatima. Both of them are actually, Fatima was a lot older than Aisha. Show me one hadith that states Aisha had a good relationship with Fatima. You won't find. Why? Because Aisha was extremely venomous. She was extremely hateful to Fatima. So when I talk like this, you're going to say, oh my God, that is a Shia talk. It's not Shia talk. It's some of our sheikhs who paid with their lives documented these facts. Aisha hated Ali so much that she wouldn't mention his name. And this is mentioned in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So it's not like some Shia talk. No, it is our talk. You never hear anything bad about Aisha, even though she was the reason over 10,000 of the good people were killed in a one single battle, and the history of the evil she did is boundless. But for us today, they tell our mother Aisha was good. If you say one word bad about Aisha, the whole world falls on your head, even though the Quran has criticized her. But no! Because why? The decree said that Aisha must never ever be spoken ill about her, no matter what she did. But, of course, you cannot also be against Muawiyah. The evil Muawiyah, the great evil man, what he did. Forget all the history. If I have to mention one evil of what Muawiyah did, was that he changed the Islamic ruling from Khilafah, from Shura, democracy and whatever, into a kingdom. And he, from him until now, Muslims are all in trouble because of what he did in the early days of Islam. But anyhow, the problem. But anyhow, so even after the death of Al-Qadir Billah, this king, his Islamic policies remained in force. They were the de facto law by which all else must be judged. From the 3rd century, And the Quran, my dear sisters and my brothers, the history of alienating the Quran began from the 3rd century. Slowly, the Quran was removed from people's lives. Until today, you tell them, Allah says, people have no, they don't believe you. They insult you just because you say Allah says in the Quran. It has become an insult. It has become out of al-Islam to mention what Allah says in al-Quran. It's in fact, a law was created, and I'm here going to fast forward to the 433, that is around 13 years after the death of the king. His son came to the power, and he noticed that some scholars were not following what his father said, and some of them were becoming lenient, and they were not pushing for what his father said in the decree, so he issued a warning to them. And all of them were again gathered, and guess what? The entire decree was read to them, and they took again allegiance, and they agreed that they're gonna do as they did before. So every Jum'ah, they would teach people that decree. The khutbah of the Jum'ah became about that decree. All the sheikhs of the Islamic world were to know again and refresh their knowledge about the Qadiri Creed or Al-Wasiqa Al-Qadiriya. The sheikhs will never ever tell you this, because the sheikhs we have today in 2021 are a produce of that decree. They don't know, well, they know it, but it's like, how can you tell a fish that it is wet? It lives in the water. You can't tell the fish that it is wet. So exactly like that. In fact, a law was created with 5 matters, with 5 points in it. If anyone doesn't believe at least in one of these things, if the moment you don't believe in one of any of the 5, you shall be executed on the spot. Nothing, no mercy, nothing. Here are the 5 points. You're going to find out why we are in the state we are in today. Number one, anyone who puts Ali before Abu Bakr or Umar will be killed. That's why the sheikhs always start with Abu Bakr, Umar. Hardly ever you find a sheikh, ask them, who are the first khalifas? He will always, they never make a mistake. Ali can never be put in front of Abu Bakr or Umar. You did that, you'd be killed. You'd be killed. And this, of course, put the Shia out and any other sheikh in the Sunni world, because the hadith and the way things were, Ali should have been the Khalifa, not Abu Bakr. Ali was, subhanAllah, he began with Islam from the year 5 of his life, and he's grown in it by now. But if I was at that time, I'd be killed by now. Point number 2. So make sure you don't put Ali before Abu Bakr or Umar. That's what it is. Point number 2. Anyone who attacks Aisha, says anything ill about her, shall be killed. All the books of hadith and the tafsir and everything don't speak the truth about Aisha. They sugarcoat it. They make Aisha always come innocent from anything she did. But hey, that's history. Number 3, anyone who criticizes Muawiyah shall be killed on the spot. Muawiyah traded in wine, in idols, in crosses. Muawiyah fornicated. Muawiyah did. No, Muawiyah is an angel sent to God from heaven. But if you said anything bad against Muawiyah, guess what? He'll be killed on the spot. The sheikhs until today teach this. Number 4, anyone who doesn't perform salat is killed right there and then. And that's why they tell you the one who doesn't perform salat is kafir. And in Saudi Arabia, not long ago, someone who doesn't pray is separated from his wife, and is, if they die, he won't be buried in the graveyard where Muslims are buried. Number 5, and this is anyone who doesn't believe that the Quran, the word of Allah, is ancient, is old, very old, and that all actions of humans are written in advance before they did them, and that Allah has already planned and predestined everything, it is death on the spot. You know how many people were killed because of this? Lots of people. And they were wrongly killed. Because all it takes is someone to just think, if Allah had predecreed everything, And he has written, for example, yeah, in the Quran, Allah says, "An-nafsu bin-nafs." You kill somebody, you must get killed. That's why, that's it. So if I go and kill somebody at the court of law, they say, "Why did you kill him?" I said, "Well, Allah has written this. It already has been predestined. And no matter what I could have done, I could never, ever have avoided that." Would the judge accept that? Would the jury accept this excuse? Or if someone steals and burgles your house and is caught and he tells you, "You know what? I didn't intend to. It is Allah who had predestined and predetermined that I should steal your house and burgle you and mug you. Please excuse me. I would never have hurt you. Blame Allah." Of course, this is nonsense. But this is what the decree had said. And until today, everything, the sheikhs, that's why we live in the confusion in which we live, is the sheikhs cannot break away from the fact that we are 100% free for our actions. Everything is with Qadarullah. And you find books written, and so many people, as I said, have been killed because of this nonsense. In year 460, that is over 40 years later, the scholars of Baghdad, one more time, and always remember, Baghdad was the capital of the Muslim Empire. They held another meeting in which they renewed their allegiance to the Qadiri decree, that it must be promoted and it must be always reminded to people on Jum'ah prayers. And one of these people, of these great sheikhs that were at the table of the king, after cursing anyone who went against this decree, he said, "There is no creed for us except what this decree holds." And believe it or not, that decree is the curriculums in the Muslim universities. They teach that decree. Every khutbah, every talk, every book you read teaches that decree. They tell you this is the Islam of Allah. It is not the Islam of Allah. That's why they hardly ever use what Allah says. Allah in the Quran says, "La ikraha fi din." There is no compulsion. We can't force someone in this religion. The hadith tells you, the Messenger of Allah said, "I was ordered to fight people until they bear witness that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger." So I've spoken about this in my previous talk. In the Quran, Allah talks about how wealth should be divided between the people, the inheritors. The hadith gives another point. Everything that Muslims are doing today is done based on the Messenger of Allah said, not on Allah ordered us to do, as we should. But alhamdulillah, with this continuous fight to make the Quran the primary source and the only source, yes, it's painful. Yes, they insult us. Yes, they accuse us. Yes, they tell us we're going to hellfire for eternity. Yes, 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 yes. Our problem is it's these people don't know anything about history. They don't know that the Islam they follow in was decided and written on paper, pushed on every Muslim since 420. Of course, the writing of al-Islam started on the 3rd century, but the imposing on people that they must believe like this has been done from the 420, and that paper exists until today. This is why al-Quran must get back to the driver's seat. It cannot stay on the back passenger seat just watching what people are doing. No. On Judgment Day, when Allah talks to us, He's going to tell us what's in the Quran and you. On Judgment Day, there will only be the Quran by itself. There is no Bukhari, no Muslim, nobody except the Quran. You see, every sheikh you hear today preaches the Qadiri decree of the year 420. So when Muhammad bin Salman decided to take the Islam back to the Quran, what he in fact has decided, and the sheikhs know this very well, and I am sure he is aware of it, and he has decided to put an end to an over 1,000 years of brainwashing, 1,000 years of people following a piece of paper written by a human being, by a king, 1,000 years away from what Allah said. Of course, I'm saying 1,000 years because it's been made publicly official. Otherwise, the deviance started from year 30 or 40 after the death of the messenger. My dear sisters and my brothers, it is extremely important that the Islam that is followed today is not what Allah said we should follow. It is a parallel religion. It looks like Islam, we hear a lot about it, but as a truth of thing is, once you start applying the Islam which is in the Quran, you find it simple, you find it easy, you find it not cumbersome, you find it light, you find it pleasing, you find it beautiful, you find the Islam of the Quran tells you, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا, and say goodness, say good things to people. The Quran, that is the Islam that is in the Quran, tells us that Allah has made us different populations, groups, tribes, so that we get to know each other. We learn from each other experiences, and that the best of us is the most pious to Allah. Meaning, I interact with a Jew, with a Christian, with a Hare Krishna, with a Buddhist. I can have them as friends, invite them over for dinner. I don't have to do it with the da'wah. For inviting them to Islam. No, I can be their friend, love them for the humans that they are. On Judgment Day, Allah will judge them, and He knows based on what He will judge them. Where they will go, Jannah, not Jannah, what's going on, it's none of my business. My business on earth is to create a link. And this is why Allah all the time in the Quran, and this is one ayah that has been misused, abused, turned. When Allah says, Alladhina amanu, those who believe, wa amilu salihat, and they do the good deeds. In our concept from this Qadiri think is that those who believe in Allah and do the good deeds, they perform salat and do the dhikr and tasbih. But that is not, because the word amana in the Quran can take different shapes. What Allah is speaking about here, when He wants you to believe in something, He always says, amanu billah, they believe in Allah. That He adds something behind the amanu to make it a belief. When Allah drops the amanu, in the context, a lot of times, it means those who are peaceful on earth, as opposed to الَّذِينَ وَإِذَا تَوَلَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَفْسَدَ فِيهَا. When someone wants to cause mischief on earth, what he does, he creates mischief and corruption on it. Amana is the opposite of that. عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, do good deeds for the good, for the well-being of humanity. But our sheikhs, because of this decree, have changed the face of Islam until now. This is why, my dear sisters and my brothers, what Muhammad ibn Salman has done now is really completely destroy a fake Islam that has been with us, that plagued us for centuries. You might ask questions, La ilaha illallah, what about the people who died? I tell you, on Judgment Day, it is not my business or your business. We seek forgiveness for them. We ask forgiveness for them. These people, when they lived, they had their excuses. Allah knows them. It is not mine. All what it is, we will say, Rabbana, اغفر لنا ولإخواننا. Ya Allah, forgive us and to our brothers, الذين سبقونا في الإيمان, who were before us in the belief. These people believed in Allah, the last day, the angels, the denomination of the faith, they had them. Ya Allah, forgive them. I'm not going to sit here and tell you, oh, these people, they didn't follow the Quran, they are kafirs, hellfire. No, it's not up to me. Even today, if people, when I talk to them and they become like my sworn enemies, I don't care about that. Me is, I tell them what I tell them, and I let them deal with it. They are responsible over their actions. It's not up to me to say he is or she is going to hellfire or they are not. It's not up to me. Always remember this. That's what the Quran says. You interrupt with people as a good well-being and leave the rest to Allah. Finally, I'll pray to Allah that this Muhammad bin Salman will get successful in putting the Quran on the seat of the drivers where he will drive al-Islam. You and me will be happy later on when we are no longer referred to as the Quranis, the people who deny the Sunnah, the people who hate Rasulullah, the people who all the accusations. Guess why? Because pretty soon the sheikhs in Saudi Arabia will start promoting the Quran and the Quran alone. Because pretty soon, any sheikh who preaches other than what the crown prince said, which is the Quran, will be called to accountability, and many of the sheikhs will start going to jail, and that's when they start only going to Quran. They will study the Quran and they will preach the Quran. You and me will be happy, because a lot of people will go, oh, so we were actually victims. You're right when you said that. And we can tell them, I told you so. Or we can say, Alhamdulillah, I'm happy for you to have finally understood. Again, this is your brother, Abdus Salam. I wanted just to share with you this extremely important pieces of information that will empower you in your continuous struggle to push the Quran on the forefront. And I pray to Allah to help us. Because my dear sisters and my brothers, the people that really suffered really are the messengers of Allah. And they suffered with the same things that we suffer today, is when their people do not accept their message for a reason or another. And we do the same thing. We push in the Quran, people don't accept it. They insult us, they accuse us, they tell us all these things. But that's how the cookie crumbles. We don't expect people to hand us roses. We gotta struggle, and that's what the struggle is all about. I pray to Allah to help us all. You have a wonderful day. And until my next talk, please remain in the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.